Jim Lansing, with what he did, absolutely made it possible for the musician to get a very close reproduction of what he wished to hear. There were three or four people in the speaker business that I'd rub elbows with, and none of them even approached what I was looking for till I got it with Jim Lansing. Somewhere there's music, he said to me, he says, "What is your name?" And I says, "Les Paul." And he says, "I'm Jim Lansing." And I says, "Gee, I've been wanting to meet you." I says, "I've heard about you." And he says, "What brought you over?" And I says, "Well, I came over to get a speaker for my studio. I'm building a recording studio in my garage in the backyard." And he says, "Well, I'm working on a speaker. It's going to be a coaxial speaker. It's going to be a duplex speaker." I said, "What's that?" He says, "Well, it's so that you're on axis with the center and with the sides." And so he says, "It's feeding you from one source." So he says, "What you'd like, I imagine, for your studio would be an Iconic." And I says, "I think that would be great, because," I says, "I never can get that guitar to sound like it really is." He says, "What do you mean, the guitar? Your guitar is never going to go through my speaker." And I laughed, and I says, "It's going to go through it somehow later anyway." And it was only a short time, maybe two or three days, that he says, "Hey, you want to go with us out in the desert?" So I says, "What's happening out there?" And he says, "Well, we're going to do some testing." And so we got in the truck. There was another fellow with us. There was three of us. And then we would do this thing out on the desert. He'd send this signal to the speakers with the microphone using a Western Electric ball bat mic. And that was a condenser mic that was the absolute. And at that time, that was the mic that was used by Western Electric at Bell Labs, and it was the same one that Jim Lansing was using. I learned more from Jim Lansing at that time, and although it was pioneering very rough, like the Wright brothers, which is pretty close, we started from the ass end and worked back. And it struck me as being just about as logical as anything else. Now, he can chart it, he can do anything he wishes with it, but the bottom line is, how does it sound? I think we had something in common. Me, I had the music ability and enough electronic ability so that I could talk with him and converse with him on his level, and he could come over on my level. And so he just kind of latched onto me. I was a lot better than the guy in the raincoat that said it sounds a little tinny over here or a little muffled over there, you know. Or woody sound. They had skinny sound. They had a lot of ways of expressing it, but he wanted it in numbers. One of the meetings that I had with Jim Lansing that was so interesting is that he laid this on me, and I've never forgotten it, and I constantly think about it. But he's telling me about the human ear and how it's a nonlinear device. And we began talking about the speaker and how we're going to enclose this speaker. And then Jim brought out the fact, something I'd never realized, that you have to divide the labor, because the range of the human ear goes so low, and you got the next range and the next range and the next range, that you can't do this on one speaker. And when he presented that to me, I was very impressed with that, and it's never left me, because it looked like a dead-end street, that it never could be right if you're going to divide that labor. And that the ultimate someday would have a device so that it's all in one, like your ear is. The tweeter woofer system, the iconic system he had, if you could back away a certain distance, That was the best sound that I've heard to this date. I haven't heard really much improvement in 50 years. I'm ready to fall. When I went to Jim, he wasn't ready to even think of the idea of making musical instrument speakers. And this didn't get to him. And like I say, a year after he died, I was down at the Nashville. I was at Carnegie Hall with Count Basie and everything. Count Basie, those guys would come over and say, "Goodness, what have you got? I could blow their whole band away with my 604. Do you realize until the electric guitar came in, he couldn't be heard? When he was an acoustical guitar, he was the most anemic person. The stand-up bass was extinct. It was becoming a nothing because no one could hear the bass. You amplify the bass and now it's big. So this is where Jim Lansing was bringing forward to us. Every kid with his rock band out there today has to thank Jim Lansing for it. And I says, "I wonder what would happen, Jim, if God came down and gave you a perfect speaker." And he thought about it a minute and he says, "Well, I don't know." And I says, "I don't either. I wonder if we'd accept it."